Welcome to One Black Man's View, providing you with news and commentary on social and political issues concerning North Carolina. My name is Scotty Reed. The News and Observer is reporting that the U.S. Department of Education plans to investigate allegations of racism filed by the NAACP against the Wake County school system. Earlier this year in March, the Wake County School Board voted 5-4 to move away from a long-standing diversity policy in favor of community-based assignments, citing budgetary problems. The move was met with stiff opposition from the NAACP and its state president, Reverend William Barber. Barber and others have called the board's decision a move that will re-segregate public schools, harkening back to the days of Jim Crow. The Charlotte Observer is reporting that the U.S. Department of Education is reviewing 5 civil rights complaints alleging that Charlotte Mecklenburg School closings and other assignment changes discriminate against Black and Hispanic students. While the U.S. Department of Education is only reviewing the allegations and has not announced an investigation into the complaints, the NAACP North Carolina chapter is thought to be behind those complaints as well. State President Reverend William Barber and the president of the Charlotte NAACP chapter, Kojo Nantambu, both recently spoke at a meeting held at Little Rock AME Zion Church, located near Uptown Charlotte, and vowed to fight the school board's plans to close about 10 schools because of budget shortfalls. School board chair Eric Davis and other members say the changes are based on low enrollment and/or academic weakness, not on race or clout. It's just the start of a quest to cut up to $100 million from next year's $1 billion budget, said Davis. In both school systems, allegations of racism seem to be a common theme. In Charlotte, opponents are claiming that predominantly white schools are not being closed while predominantly black schools are being targeted. It appears too many that the North Carolina NAACP is trying to have it both ways. In Wake County, they are opposed to the school board moving towards a community-based school assignment plan, while in Charlotte, they want community schools to stay open, regardless of their academic achievement record, even though students of the proposed closed schools would be assigned to the nearest schools that also have better academic success with students. At the Charlotte meeting, NAACP chapter president Kojo Nantambu claimed that when a community loses a school, that community dies. So in the case of Wake County, is the opposite true? When a community has a local school, does it come alive, despite its record of academic achievement? It is hard to make sense of the NAACP's stance. For historical context, consider that in the Supreme Court decision, Brown versus the Board of Education, directed by the NAACP leadership, African American parents attempted to enroll their children in the closest neighborhood schools in the fall of 1951. Because of racial segregation, the students were denied entry into those schools that were closer to their homes than the black schools that they were assigned to. The named plaintiff in the landmark case had a daughter who was in the third grade. She had to walk 6 blocks to her school bus stop to ride to Monroe Elementary, her segregated black school that was 1 mile away, while the white school, Sumner Elementary, was only 7 blocks from her home. Therefore, it seems that the chief goal of the lawsuit was to allow black children to attend neighborhood schools that were better funded and equipped to give students a better education and not for diversity reasons. From my research, although black schools were not funded equally and often had to deal with substandard equipment, texts, and buildings compared to their white counterparts, the black students received a better education than the majority of black students do today. It appears prior to Brown versus the Board of Education, black parents and their children placed more of a value on education than many black parents and students do today. That is the ugly truth that no one in the black community cares to admit. One must also note that back then, The black community was not bombarded with mass media that promotes a culture of coonery and buffoonery like we see in the programming produced by BET and other so-called black media outlets. It is a fact that mass media controls the minds of the masses, and today the masses' minds are controlled by a culture that does not place a value on a quality education, but teaches values based on materialism and getting things by any means necessary, including means that may be illegal. This media programming has led to a culture of low moral standards and diminished intellectual capacity. Some critics say this is by design in the much-discussed school-to-prison pipeline theory. Many claim racial and economic diversity should be the goal of our school system. But how much diversity are we really getting when predominantly white schools, predominantly black, and Latino schools still exist? The main goal of our school should be to make sure every student receives a quality education and provided with every resource they need to succeed. How important is diversity to Americans when every Sunday adults, along with their children, attend segregated houses of religious worship by choice? Yes, diversity is important, but it can be achieved by other means like cultural exchanges where schools work with one another to plan social and academic events where the children of various cultures and ethnic backgrounds can come together, compete, and work together. More importantly, it is my belief that school curriculum should be targeted for diversification so that it reflects the religious, scientific, academic, and cultural contributions to American society by all groups instead of focusing primarily on one so-called dominant ethnic group. This would go far in instilling ethnic pride in minority groups, which psychologists say is very important to African American males especially, and will also teach respect of other cultures and ethnic groups to children of European descent. It is very troubling that the NAACP, or anyone else for that matter, in North Carolina is not holding the black community responsible in all of this. No matter what side of the issue individual parents find themselves on in Wake County or Charlotte-Mecklenburg County. During the civil rights movement, turning out the black vote was a priority. Community engagement by the black religious institutions was high. Even though the school board members who voted to go to a community-based assignment policy in Wake County made this a central part of their campaigns to get elected to the school board, black voter turnout was very low. Only one member of the Wake County School Board is of African descent. If the black community was so concerned about this policy, then why did it not make its opposition known through the ballot box, instead of holding rallies and protests screaming racism after the election? Why do we not have more members of the community engaging the system and taking ownership of their communities by participating in the democratic process as candidates and voters? It is my opinion that the black community needs to stop complaining about policies enacted after an election of any kind when they do not care enough, it seems, to be part of the solution instead of being part of the problem. The black community needs to rebuild itself and become more self-reliant and think about these issues critically and stop allowing itself to be misled by groups that seem to have outlived their usefulness. Parents who do not participate in their children's educational development need to be held accountable. A system that's based on sending a few poor black or Latino children to schools outside of their communities based on their parents' socioeconomic status is still leaving the majority of that same community students behind, and it is not a just, fair, or equitable solution to the education problems these communities face. Stay tuned for these messages, your calls, and plus more commentary from one black man.